definitely, you know, set us back, and it's the kind of thing that we don't want to see happen. Would like to learn more about how it happened, what we're going to do to prevent that type of thing in the future. And with that, I will yield back and look forward to the testimony. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, sir. General Campbell, again, welcome. The floor is yours for any without objection, your full written opening statement will be made part of the record, and the floor is yours for any comments you'd like to make.
Sir, thank you. Good morning, Chairman Thornberry, Ranking Member Smith, distinguished members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today. I'm honored to lead and represent the servicemen and women of the United States Forces Afghanistan that have been there for the last 14 years, and I've been in Afghanistan for this tour for the last 14 months. I'd like to begin by thanking the committee for your steadfast support of the soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and civilians, and due to your leadership and commitment, they're the best trained, equipped force our nation has ever deployed. Their outstanding performance bears testimony to your backing and the backing of the American people. I'm also profoundly grateful for your continued support of the Afghan Security Forces Fund. Our ongoing efforts to build the Afghan National Army and the police could never have been possible without your financial commitment and your trust. Every day we strive to be good stewards of the American taxpayers' money to ensure that our efforts result in increased security. Members of the committee have also been staunch promoters of women in the Afghan security forces. Your efforts are making a difference. An integrated force is better and a more effective force. And you deserve to be proud of the advances that the courageous Afghan women are now making in the Afghan National Army and Afghan police. I'd also like to pay tribute to our military families. They're the unsung heroes of the last 14 years of conflict. In many ways, our frequent absences from home are harder on them than they are on us. And without their love and support, we couldn't succeed. Finally, I'd like to acknowledge and honor the over 2,200 servicemen and women who've been killed in Afghanistan since 2001, and the over 20,000 who've been wounded. Tragically, we lost 14 personnel, to include 6 airmen and 4 U.S. contractors last Friday in an aircraft mishap. And we always remember the Afghan and our own fallen and the loved ones that they've left behind. Every day we honor their memories by assisting the Afghans to build a stable and secure country and by protecting our own homeland. Over 14 years have passed since the 9/11 attacks, and we haven't forgotten why we first came to Afghanistan and why we remain. Since 2001, the exceptional efforts and courage of our forces have ensured that another terrorist attack originating from Afghanistan and directed against the U.S. homeland has not occurred. 7 months have passed since I last appeared before this committee, and much has changed since then. Afghanistan, its government, security forces, the enemy, and our own coalition have undergone tremendous transitions. These changes have ensured that this fighting season has been fundamentally different. It can't be compared to previous years. I would like to emphasize how political, military, economic, and social transitions are affecting the operational environment in order to place our campaign in context. Afghanistan is at a critical juncture, and so is our campaign. But before I further explain the formidable challenges and opportunities before us, I'd like to address a few topics that have been in the headlines lately. First, I'd like to discuss the tragic loss of lives on the strike on the hospital in Kunduz. By way of background, the U.S. Special Operations Forces have been providing training, advice, and assistance to Afghan security forces who had been engaged in a tenacious fight with the Taliban. On Saturday morning, our forces provided close air support to Afghan forces at their request. But to be clear, the decision to provide aerial fires was a U.S. decision made within the U.S. chain of command. A hospital was mistakenly struck, and we would never intentionally target a protected medical facility. I must allow the investigation to take its course, and therefore I'm not at liberty to discuss further specifics at this time. However, I assure you that the investigation will be thorough, objective, and transparent, and I will get those results back to this committee. I'd also like to remind the committee and the American people that we continue to make extraordinary efforts to protect civilians. No military in history has done more to avoid harming innocents. We've readily assumed greater risk to our own forces in order to protect non-combatants. To prevent any future incidents of this nature, I've directed the entire force to undergo in-depth training in order to review all of our operational authorities and rules of engagement. Our record stands in stark contrast to the actions of the Taliban. They've repeatedly violated laws of war by intentionally targeting civilians. The United Nations attributes more than 70% of noncombatants killed and wounded in this war to the Taliban. Second, I would like to discuss the sexual exploitation of children by some members of the Afghan security forces. All of us consider it reprehensible. This criminal practice is entirely unacceptable to the Afghans as well. President Ghani, Chief Executive Abdullah have reiterated that they will not tolerate violations of their policies and the Afghan law, and they're committed to strict enforcement within their security forces. We'll do everything within our power to defend and protect human rights. That's our moral obligation to you, the American people, and ourselves. I've ordered 100% training of the force to ensure that they understand our human rights policy, which has been in place since at least 2011. And this policy requires that our personnel report any suspected human rights violations committed by the Afghan security forces, to include any sexual abuse of children. Whenever and wherever our personnel observe human rights abuses, they will be conveyed through our chain of command and in turn to the Afghan government. Perpetrators must and will be held accountable. With still many weeks left in the traditional fighting season, intense combat continues in many parts of the country. The Afghan security forces have been severely tested this year, but they continue to fight hard. In the wake of the coalition's redeployment, the Afghan security forces and insurgents both accepted that this fighting season could be pivotal. There was no winter lull, and since February, the fighting has been nearly continuous. Casualties on both sides have risen, and the violence has moved beyond the traditional insurgent strongholds. Pakistan military operations this year foreign fighters into eastern and northern Afghanistan. The emergence of Daesh, or the Islamic State Khorasan Province, ISKP, has further complicated the theater landscape and potentially expanded the conflict. More recently, the Taliban increased the tempo of their operations following the announced death of their spiritual leader, Mullah Omar. We're also now seeing how our redeployment and our transition from combat operations to an advisory role has really changed the battlefield dynamics. Only a few years ago, our coalition numbered over 140,000 military personnel. Now our force is comprised of fewer than 14,000, of which approximately 10,000 are U.S. servicemen and women. In years past, our aircraft provided responsive and often decisive close air support to coalition and Afghan troops in contact. This is no longer the norm, but the exception. Collectively, the Afghan security forces are adapting to these changes, and in some places, they're struggling. Within this context, the fluidity of the current security situation is not surprising. This fighting season started well for the Afghan National Army and the police as they successfully conducted multi-core cross-pillar operations in Helmand, Zabul, and Ghazni provinces, and then the southern approaches into Kabul. In April, they fought back significant Taliban pressure in the north. And in August and September, they reversed almost all of the Taliban gains in northern Helmand, but after considerable effort. Yet there have been setbacks, and most recently, the Taliban overran Kunduz City. Still, the Afghan National Army, the police, and the special forces rallied, and they've regained control of most of the city. Just as they've successfully retaken other ground, temporarily lost through this fighting season. The Afghan security forces' inconsistent performance in Kunduz underscores several of their shortcomings. They must improve their intelligence fusion, command and control, and utilization of their forces. They don't possess the necessary combat power and numbers to protect every part of the country. This makes it very difficult for the Afghan security forces to counter the Taliban's ability to temporarily mass, seize an objective, and then blend back into the population. Ultimately, the Afghan security forces and their leaders need to discern better when to fight, when to hold, and where to assume risk. Despite these shortcomings, however, the Afghan security forces have displayed courage and resilience, and they're still holding. The Afghan government retains control of Kabul, of Highway 1, its provincial capitals, and nearly all of the district centers. The Afghan security forces are effectively protecting the principal population centers. It's also apparent that our advisory support and financial backing are strengthening the resolve and building their systems and processes for the future. The Afghan National Army and police have repeatedly shown that without key enablers and competent operational level leaders, they cannot handle the fight alone in this stage of their development. Ultimately, I'm convinced that improved leadership and accountability will address most of their deficiencies, but it will take time for them to build their human capital. The Afghan security forces' uneven performance this fighting season also underscores their shortfalls that will persist well beyond this year. Capability gaps still exist in fixed and rotary wing aviation, combined arms, intelligence, and maintenance. One of the greatest tactical challenges for the Afghan security forces has been overcoming the Afghan Air Force's still extremely limited close air support capability. Despite a myriad of challenges, the fundamental partnership between the coalition and the Afghan government remains durable. The difference between the Ghani administration and the previous administration is like night and day. And at every level, the coalition and Afghan leaders continue to work together in pursuit of shared strategic objectives. The Afghan government, civil leaders, and military commanders demonstrate a growing appreciation for the coalition's efforts. President Ghani has asked NATO and the U.S. to provide some flexibility in our planning to account for the fact that his government remains in transition while the threats it faces are changing. He's asserted that a sustained coalition and a U.S. presence provides actual and psychological stability to the country as a new government solidifies. He recognizes that his new administration must invest considerable time and effort to address the challenges of systemic corruption. And he has also acknowledged that while the Afghan security forces are better equipped and trained than ever, much work remains to build their systems and processes and improve their leader development. I've offered my chain of command several options for a future laydown in 2016 and beyond. It was envisioned in mid-2014 that we would transition to a normalized embassy presence by January 2017. That remains our planning assumption. Since that time, much has changed. We've seen the rise of Daesh or ISIL, an increased al-Qaeda presence in Afghanistan due to Pakistan military operations, and now we have a strong partner in President Ghani and Chief Executive Abdullah. And as a result, I put forward recommendations to adjust to this new environment while addressing our core missions of train, advise, and assist the Afghan security forces, and to conduct counterterrorism operations to protect the homeland. An upsurge in the insurgent violence in northern Helmand and Kunduz shows that Afghanistan is at a critical moment in their history. President Obama is well aware of the tenuous security situation, and I also appreciate that he has many other global issues to weigh as he considers my recommendations. My role is to provide him my best military advice based upon my assessment of conditions on the ground, weighed against the risks, both to the force and to the mission. I'm unable to discuss further details on the options I provided to the President. In the past, when flexibility has been requested of him, he took it under serious consideration and made his decision. He provided flexibility this year. The same decision process is being worked through now for 2016 and beyond. In closing, the challenges before us are still significant. An extremely tough fight the Afghan security forces continue to hold. They've remained resilient, and they haven't fractured. Fully supported and led by an engaged commander-in-chief in President Ghani, embraced by the Afghan people, and backstopped by our military advisors, our resources, and our enablers, the Afghan security forces' future and Afghanistan's prospects for an eventual peace still remain promising. If we fail in this worthwhile mission, Afghanistan will once again become a sanctuary for al-Qaeda and other terrorists bent on attacking our interests and citizens abroad and at home. Likewise, if we withdraw from Afghanistan, a security vacuum will arise, and other extremist networks, such as Daesh, could rapidly expand and sow unrest throughout Central and South Asia and potentially target our homeland. The hard work and sacrifices of countless coalition military personnel and civilians over the last 14 years have created the conditions in which the Afghans can and are taking responsibility for their own security and governance. The Afghans welcome the opportunity to share their destiny, but they still desire, need, and deserve our assistance. Our support cannot and should not be indefinite or unconditional. The Afghans must continue to do their part, and if they do, we should continue to exercise strategic patience and sustain our commitment to them. Working together, we can be successful. A proactive, cooperative Ghani administration, a committed Afghan security force, offer us a unique opportunity to further develop a meaningful strategic relationship in a volatile but vital area of the world. Our continued efforts to stabilize Afghanistan will benefit the entire region and in turn offer greater security for the U.S. homeland and Americans abroad and here at home. Thank you, sir, again for the opportunity to testify before this committee. Thank you for your steadfast support of our campaign. I look forward to your questions, and sir, as you already said, request that my written remarks and written statement be taken for the record. Thank you, sir.
Great. Thank you, sir. General, there were two statements you made in the early part of your testimony that jumped out at me. One was, and I'll read the sentence back, since 2001, the extraordinary efforts of both our conventional and special operation forces have ensured that another terrorist attack originating from Afghanistan and directed against the U.S. homeland has not occurred. You know, I think there's a lot of frustration when you read the news from day to day about the ups and downs, but I think it's really important for all of us to keep that basic fact in mind. For 14 years, there has not been another attack from there directed against our homeland. And I got to tell you, on the morning of September 11, 2001, I would have never expected us to go 14 years without another attack. And the reason it hadn't is because of what you say. Extraordinary efforts, heroism by men and women who have served there, including some members of this committee who have served there. So I think it's important to just keep in mind the broader accomplishment. The other thing that jumped out at me was your comment about Afghan casualties. When I was there a month ago, I stood next to you at a ceremony where we remembered and honored the Afghans who lost their lives. All of us get frustrated when we're there to try to help somebody who's not willing to stand up and fight for themselves. My impression is, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, the Afghans are willing to stand up and fight for themselves. And they have lost a lot of lives in doing that. Which is part of the reason that our partnership is working better. If you want to make a comment on that.
Sure, you're absolutely right. I mean, the Afghan security forces, the Afghan people in general, are warriors. They want to protect their homeland. The Afghan people absolutely think that the Afghan army, the police, they rate them as their number one institution in the country. But there is no doubt in my mind that they have the resilience, they have the will of character to continue to stand and fight to protect their homeland.
Thank you. General, I just want to ask some numbers right quick. I understand you've made recommendations to the President. You cannot talk about those. But today we have about 9,800 American service members in Afghanistan, correct?
Sure, that's correct.
Okay. About how many of them are involved in the counterterrorism efforts?
So if I could take that for record, I'd get you the exact number. But roughly, we're talking probably 1,300 of those 9,800 are directly day-to-day tied into train, advise, and assist. It takes a lot to continue to support that, but at least 1,300 are every day, what we call level one TAA.
Okay, I'm sorry. So about 1,300 of them are involved in day-to-day training and assisting the Afghan forces. Does that include the people who are helping the bureaucracy inside Kabul?
So that's inside Kabul and outside Kabul, yes, sir.
Okay, do you have any estimate, and I realize I'm stretching you, but any estimate about how many people are in day-to-day contact training and advising Afghan forces outside of Kabul?
So that number's probably about 500.
Okay. So about 500 American servicemen are really doing what I see as the train equip. About how many are involved in the counterterrorism mission, you reckon?
So I'd rather cover that in a closed hearing with you if I could.
Okay. I guess what I'm trying to think is if we have some reduction in the 9,800 that are there now, we will be able to do less, right, of something.
Sure, it would limit our ability to train, advise, and assist. Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Ms. Smith.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Can you talk to us a little bit, General, about the relationship between Afghanistan and Pakistan and the various groups that are involved there? And I guess related to that is the conversation about reconciliation talks between the Taliban and the Afghan government. First of all, what hopes do you have for that? Second of all, no matter what comes out of that, there will always be groups on both sides of the border that aren't part of it. Can you tell us a little bit about the groups that would be involved, who might be reconcilable, who we might still have to fight, and how the relationship between Afghanistan and Pakistan factors into those negotiations?
Sure, thanks for the question. So as you know, very complicated between Pakistan and Afghanistan. I do try to maintain ties with Pakistan. I talk to General Raheel Sharif, the chief of the army in Pakistan, probably once a week. I try to get to Pakistan once a month. We really work hard to make sure that the Afghans and the Pakistan military conduct mill-to-mill discussions to continue to improve upon their ability to fight the same common enemy on that border. Reconciliation is going to take time, sir. It's going to take both Afghanistan and Pakistan to working together, although President Ghani has said many times that reconciliation will be Afghan-led, and he and the rest of the government there continues to work that very hard. They've had at least one really sanctioned talk on reconciliation that's been out public, and that was back probably in the June timeframe, facilitated by Pakistan to bring some Taliban to the table to talk. Working toward a second talk, but that happened the same week that the announcement of Mullah Omar's death, so that kind of stopped that talk. I think reconciliation talks will continue, but it's going to take some time to bring the right people to the table to do that. The Taliban currently are a little bit in disarray based on who's in charge. Mullah Mansour is trying to take charge from his perspective, but there's a lot of other fragments of the Taliban because they do fight really decentralized, but a lot of other factions of the Taliban are trying to not follow Mansour. So I think it's going to take a good couple of months before we see them coming back to any kind of peace negotiation. But Afghanistan and Pakistan both realize that there has to be a political solution to this problem, that they're not going to kill everybody. I think Afghanistan and President Ghani especially has expended a lot of political capital the last 6 or 7 months to try to work that with Pakistan. He has not seen a lot in return, therefore has taken, again, a lot of challenges from within his own government, but I think he's been very courageous in how he has reached out. I think General Raheel, the same way with his leadership, is trying to work that very hard. But so this is years and years of mistrust that they're trying to work through, but they know that they have to get there to come to this solution. Your question on who would reconcile and who wouldn't, sure, the estimates I've heard, both from an Afghan perspective and probably from the intel community, is anywhere between 60 or 70% is potentially reconcilable on the Taliban side. You probably would not have Haqqani, who continues to be a very, very, an enemy that is dangerous to both the coalition and the Afghan civilians, because they attack civilians. They're the ones that are responsible for the high-profile attacks in Kabul for the V-bids, the vehicle-borne IEDs. Haqqani probably would not reconcile, and there's probably members of AQ that would not reconcile, but 67% is kind of the number that's out there, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Mr. Jones.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much, and General Campbell, thank you and all of our men and women in uniform for the responsibility and also the dedication. Y'all are very special to all of us in America. I want to, in March, when you were here, I ask you a question, and this will not be my question, but it leads up to a question. My question was, will there ever be anyone in the diplomatic corps or the military who will say to the president, you know, we have done about all we can do? Then one of your answers back to me was this: for very little continued investment, we can make this, meaning Afghanistan, the shining light of Central Asia and that part of the world. We have spent about $686 billion there since the year 2001. You've already mentioned the number who have been killed and wounded. Then recently, we had in the newspaper, and you've acknowledged one of these titles: U.S. wasted billions of dollars rebuilding Afghanistan. That was in the papers back in September. Then in October, Afghan forces on the run. This was in the New York Times. Also in the New York Times, which you have acknowledged, U.S. soldiers told to ignore sexual abuse of boys by Afghan military. You know, I think a number 15 or 16, I've been here 20 years, a general, a Marine and Army, sitting right here telling us what you've told us. And I believe it. Ain't no question about that. I believe them, the other 15 who sat where you are today. Then I go back to an email that I got from the former commandant of the Marine Corps, Chuck Krulak. A few years ago, I asked him, I said, General, I don't have the military background. How successful can we be in training the Afghans to be soldiers and policemen? And of course, we realize there's a problem with education in that country, and I understand that. But let me read what he said very quickly. Get real in training an army and police force. All we're doing is training eventually new members of the Taliban. Trainers are doing a wonderful job, but we don't have the time to make an army. And he closed by saying, every day somebody dies. My question to you, we are faced with a debt of $18 trillion. We're going to be debating in about a month a debt ceiling increase so we can borrow more money from foreign governments primarily to pay the bills for last year. The American taxpayer has got to know at some point in time there's going to be an end to this investment. Money, blood, it's got to be an end to it. And I heard something you were saying a while ago, and this is going to lead to the question. At some time, I've been hearing for 15 years from the generals like yourself that training the Afghans to be policemen and security forces, it's going pretty well. It's a little fragile, but it's going pretty well. It's been going pretty well for 15 years. That's not a criticism. I'm just making an observation. We, at some point in time, as a nation and members of Congress, have got to understand that we cannot continue to, as John Sopko says, waste, fraud, and abuse is worse today than it was 15 years ago. That's not your responsibility. I understand that. But this thing has got to have an end to it. Is that when the security forces can say we don't need any advisors from the coalition forces or the American military? Will you give me some idea of how this thing is going to end the best you can?
Sure. Thanks for the question. Sir, if I could correct the record first, you said I acknowledge that we ignore the abuses, and that's not what I said. We do not. I do not. And in my statement, I said that we have policies to say you do not ignore the abuses. You report the abuses through your chain of command. So I'd like to correct the record there if I could, but what you just said. Sure. Again, on the financial piece and the continued support to the Afghan security forces and to Afghanistan and the people, you know, yesterday was 14 years. So it has been a very, very long time. But as the chairman said, we have not been attacked. Sure, we live in the world we have. Maybe not the world we want, but it's the world we have. And this world is going to continue to be a very dangerous world. And we're going to have people that want to continue to do harm to the men and women here back in the United States. And I think, as I said earlier, and I would say for a modest continued investment, we can protect not only our homeland, but continue to build.
General, I apologize for cutting you off, particularly after a four-minute question, but we have limited time and numerous members. If you ever want to extend your answer in writing, please feel free to do so, but we're going to have to try to keep to the time limits today. Ms. Sanchez.
Mr. Sir. Chairman, I, for one, appreciate the four-minute question. Thank you, Mr. Jones, for reminding this committee what is happening in Afghanistan. So, it's pretty much been a failure. General, do you know how many people we have recruited and trained over the years for the Afghan Army and police forces?
Ma'am, currently today, we're authorized to have 352,000. That includes the Army.
No. I'm not asking you what you're authorized as far as billets. I'm asking you how many people have we paid on the payroll to be over these 14 years in the Afghan Army and police?
Ma'am, I'll have to take that for record. I don't have that answer. The Army, really the 1st Battalion.
Okay, you can stop. I've only got
2004,
I've only
2005.
Got 5 minutes. So I have plenty of friends in Afghanistan who have gone over there. You know, we have phantom people on the rosters. We have 60-year-old men, uneducated, signed up for these Afghan forces. We have tons of people we are paying that aren't even showing up for work. This has been going on and on and on. Of those 360,000 billets that you say we have, how many are filled today, General?
Ma'am, the police are authorized 157,000. They have about 156,000 that are filled today. The Army are authorized 195,000. There's probably in the area of 174,000 that are filled today.
Okay. I think it would be important to get that number of how much we've spent training these people. You said in your testimony, "I remain concerned about the long-term viability of the Afghan National Defense and Security Forces. Succinctly, Afghanistan cannot afford its security forces." You mentioned that 90% of paying for these forces are from the coalition and the majority of the money is coming from the U.S. So, within your own current testimony, let alone the testimony that Mr. Jones brought before you from before, you basically are saying, "I don't know that there's a long-term viability for these security forces. We're paying the majority of that." How much is the majority? How much money does that mean to have a force that you don't believe has a long-term viability?
Ma'am,
how much? How much? That's the question. How much?
Yes, ma'am. Today, for calendar year 15, United States put $4.1 billion to build the Afghan security forces. For 16,
$4.1 billion.
$3.86 billion.
Thank you, $4.1
Every year
billion.
We'll continue to reduce that by gaining efficiencies. We're not providing
General,
infrastructure that
we've
heard in the past.
This. I've heard this for 14 years. We're going to get better. It's going to be more efficient. We're getting there. You know, the reality is that we're not. Is that we're not. I mean, Mr. Jones was right. My next question for you is, operationally, what is our strategy in Afghanistan? What is our I heard the chairman, we haven't had 14 years of attacks coming out of Afghanistan. I'll remind the chairman, instead they went to Somalia, instead they went to Yemen, instead they went to Iraq, instead they went to Syria, instead they went to Libya. So, you know, we can say we've concentrated our forces and our monies in one place, but the reality is, and you and I both know this, they move. So what is the plan for Afghanistan?
And the plan is to continue to build the Afghan security forces so they can protect the Afghan people, to have a stable government so it can provide for the Afghan people, so the Afghan people can have jobs, their kids can go to work, that they can be a viable country and
thank
that
you.
Very, very part of
thank
it.
Thank you. So $4.1 billion this year. You don't believe it's a long-term viable strategy. Let me ask you one last question before my time is up, General. Oh, and by the way, I just want to say, I just have a son who will be full-time in the U.S. infantry. We just found out. I love our forces. I think they're doing a good job. I'm talking about what we are doing as policymakers. Did we ever find out how much money Karzai and his cronies stole and put in Swiss banks?
General, if you want to provide that for the record, again, we're going to try to keep to the time limits. Mr. Forbes.
Mr. Chairman, thank you for this hearing. General, thank you for your service. You are educated at one of the best military academies we have in the world, West Point. You have not just served, but you've commanded for 35 years, leading men and women, defending this country. You've commanded in Germany, Haiti, Iraq, Afghanistan, and the United States. You get to see with a set of eyes that few of us ever get to be able to look through. It is very easy for people to come in here and recount the price tag we paid in Afghanistan. That's pretty easy. And there are people across America who ask what Mr. Jones asked, for what? What I'm going to ask you today is if, because as I look at your testimony, you have told us kind of what would have happened if we hadn't have been there, and you said in 2015, Al-Qaeda has attempted to rebuild its support networks and planning capabilities. Could you paint two pictures for us today? One, taking all that experience you have, give us, in your best professional military judgment, the danger to the United States homeland and the risk of loss of life in the United States had these individuals not made the sacrifices that you talked about, and had we as a nation not made those sacrifices. And then also, in your best professional military judgment, paint a picture for us of the danger to the United States homeland and the risk of loss to life in the United States if we pull out and do not continue to make those kinds of investments and sacrifices.
Sir, thank you for the question. Sir, again, we've been so fortunate in our country to have brave men and women that continue to join an organization that it is not about them, but about the greater good. I think all of our men and women understand that piece of it. Without their great sacrifice and the sacrifices of their families, the people back here in the homeland, the people in Europe, would be at much greater risk of terrorist attacks. I mean, I don't think there's any doubt about that. I think in the future, as we move forward, you know, we have a lot of talk about ISIL in Syria and Iraq. We have a lot of talk about Daesh growing up in Afghanistan. If it's not Daesh in 2 years, it's going to be something else. This is a generational issue. Terrorism knows no boundaries. So if we think that this is going to be cleared up in a couple of years, we're fooling ourselves. And we have to position ourselves to ensure that we can do everything we can to mitigate this impact. And the way to do that is to continue to apply pressure with the great special operating forces, the great men and women that we have in all of our services, and also to build the CT capability of Afghanistan and the other countries in the region so they can take that on themselves. And without that, the homeland would be at much greater risk.
And General, if you could, give me a little specificity. When we talk about a greater risk of terrorism, that can be kind of a general term. But if we hadn't have been in Afghanistan, if we hadn't have done this, how would it have strengthened their hands? How would they have had a greater opportunity to strike the United States and to do harm to us here at home?
Sure, they would have had sanctuary to continue to plan and devise ways that they could attack the homeland, they could attack Europe. There's no doubt, I think, in anybody's mind that there are people out there that want to do harm to people throughout the world. And this terrorism will continue for years to come, and we have to continue to do everything we can to prevent that. And the way to do that is to continue to keep pressure on it.
Good. Thank you, General. Thanks for your service and for the sacrifice that the men and women under you have made throughout the years. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. Ms. Davis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and General Campbell, thank you for your invaluable service to our country, all your sacrifices. You mentioned in your testimony that our support is not unconditional, and I wonder if you could tell us within the context of the relationship that you've built with President Ghani, which is really a quite extraordinary one, and in some ways, I guess you would say you're fortunate that you have a willing partner. Tell us more about what we could, should, where have we actually used our leverage, and clearly, you know, the fact that they can't really afford their own military and we need to be there on their behalf. What could we be doing? What have you seen that has helped to direct, to provide the impetus to move forward in governance that is really important?
Ma'am, I've seen it really at my level through MOI and MOD, Ministry of Interior, Ministry of Defense, where everything that we do is based on conditionality. They sign letters of commitment because we appropriate and move the money around based on different conditions. So we ask them, there are certain gates they have to be able to do, and if you don't do this, we're going to hold this. If you don't do this, we're going to do that. And what that is a change of behavior. You know, for many, many years, if the Afghans needed this, we would provide that to them. And what we need to do now, to make sure they're not very, very dependent upon that, we have to break that. We have to change behavior. And I think by putting conditionality on the money at the MOI and MOD level, we're able to do that. At the presidential level, and we are very fortunate, we have President Ghani and Dr. Abdullah in a unity government that wants to work not only with the U.S., but the entire international community. in the conditionality of getting after corruption. So President Ghani personally chairs a national procurement meeting every week that he looks at contracts, and he has a board that does that to get after corruption, and we've asked him to go after that. We've asked him to make some tough choices as he and Dr. Abdullah work on governors and provincial police chiefs and naming the right leadership and picking leadership based on merit, not based on patronage of who they knew. And so those are ways that we can help at the governance level as well to put those kind of conditions as we move forward. And if I could add, ma'am, President Ghani welcomes conditionality.
Has that been effective in moving some discussions as well with even Pakistanis as we move into, you know, negotiations at some point with the Taliban? I mean, is there anything that we've seen with that conditionality that's kind of pushed that situation along?
Yes, ma'am. On the Pakistan side, I think it was noted a couple months ago that both State Department and Department of Defense work every day with Pakistan to look at how they can continue to do more to fight terrorism and how they can go after Haqqani, how they can do things there that enable their forces and their people to be safe, but at the same time not destabilize Afghanistan. And so I think there are conditions that we can use with Pakistan there.
Mm-hmm. Are we able to do that as well in talking about the Constitution and the ability to withdraw, I guess, from that human rights issues? How have we been effective with that? And what else needs to be done as we move forward to ensure that those issues are dealt with?
Ma'am, I think if I saw that we needed to apply conditionality, something like that, I would absolutely do that. When I went to President Ghani on the abuse of sexual children, he absolutely got that and said, we have a law, our Constitution covers that, but I will reinforce that. I will make sure that all of my security forces understand that. And if he didn't do that, that would be something I can go back and say, Mr. President, if you don't do this, we need to look at that. But I didn't see that in that case, and we'll continue to work very hard. But again, President Ghani and Dr. Abdullah welcome the conditions. It makes them tougher. It makes them accountable. And they understand that the money, not only the money, but the blood, sweat, and tears, the ultimate sacrifice that all the nations have provided, that's special to them. Not only their own that have been lost, but the international community. So they welcome conditions, and they want to make sure that we understand that they are very appreciative of that. And so unlike where we were, you know, over a year ago without the national government, we're in a completely different place.
And you have all the authorities that you need, and no additional help from the Congress to do that?
Ma'am, I'm comfortable with the authorities I have today. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Mr. Miller.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, in 2014, a decision was made to have a troop level of 9,800. And my question, I think, is simple, but it may not be. And the question is the security situation in Afghanistan better or worse today? And if it is not better than it was then, how in the world could we even entertain talking about troop levels of 5,000 or 1,000?
Sure. Again, in 2014, the number of U.S. forces, coalition forces we had versus what we have today is different. So the security on them, I think, is one thing because, unfortunately, we have lost some great men and women over the last year, even in resolute support. But I think we've balanced that based on the number of people we've had there and the security and looking at the force protection. From an Afghan perspective, you know, again, this has been a very, very tough fighting season, and they knew it was going to be a very tough fighting season. And the Taliban knew because we were redeploying, because our numbers were going to go down, because they didn't have the same amount of close air support, they would try to send a message. And so not having close air support like we had it in the years past emboldened the Taliban in some places to go ahead and attack in larger numbers that we hadn't seen before. But again, the Afghan forces, I think, have stepped up for the most part. They've made corrections. They're resilient. There have been some setbacks, like in Kunduz and Northern Helmand, but unlike Iraq, and people try to compare Iraq and Afghanistan, and they're not the same, the Afghans have planned, have reorganized, have resupplied, have put the right leadership in place, and continue to fight and protect the people. But overall, if you take the number of security attacks and compare it from 14 to 15, it's very, very difficult because, again, we're not out there in the numbers that we were before. But it has been a very tough fight, sir, on both sides.
And I will yield the balance of my time to Mr. Turner, but I have one comment to make, and it is a plea. And I know you can't discuss the gunship incident in Kunduz, but I would plead with you, sir, please don't let the crew of that aircraft nor those Americans that were on the ground that guided that fire where they did become scapegoats.
Sir, I will look. We have an investigation, sir, as you know, and the investigation will give me the facts, and I'll make sure the committee has all of that as we learn more.
Thank you, sir. To Mr. Turner.
Thank you, Mr. Miller. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to echo Mr. Miller's comments. I think everyone is very concerned about that investigation and how it, and that those who certainly had no involvement in a mistake, no culpability in a mistake, not have consequences. General, you and I had a conversation about the 9/11 Commission report. When we first got the 9/11 Commission report delivered to this Congress, it had a chapter in it, chapter 12, that detailed what we needed to do in the future and what we shouldn't do. It specifically said that our fight was not against al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden solely, and if we viewed our fight as that, that we would lose, that it was Islamic extremism and worldwide terrorism. When we look at Iraq, it is clear that we've not heralded Chapter 12 because we've seen ISIS take hold and now threaten our homeland. You have made recommendations that we continue to hold troops in Afghanistan. You have both ISIS and Daesh, ISIL and Daesh now there. Could you tell us if you did withdraw our troops down to the level of 1,000, its effect on both the safety of our troops and the ability of our effectiveness for counterterrorism actions in Afghanistan?
So if we came down to 1,000 embassy presence, as you just discussed, there is no counterterrorism structure force in those numbers. And then if you draw down to that size in one location, you're solely dependent upon the force protection for that particular site by with and through outer layers that we would not have that we've had in the past. I'm not sure if that answers your question.
It does, which it totally cripples our ability to undertake those actions. Now, also, when you withdraw to those level of forces, aren't the forces that are left behind at a greater risk without a larger footprint?
So they are in one location. The enemy would know where they're at, but we would do everything we can to make sure we mitigate. Again, force protection, number one concern for me. And as we continue to draw down, every commander would make sure they do everything they can to ensure the right force protection.
And the fact that it would be higher risk. Entered the country, the effects of your ability to counter Daesh as they entered the country?
So again, at the 1,000 number, at an embassy presence, that there is no CT allocation in that.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Miller.
Mr. Courtney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, General, for your service and testimony here today. You have probably one of the most complex missions I think almost you could possibly even imagine. So again, we really appreciate your efforts. And again, I want to associate myself with Mr. Miller's remarks about the investigation. I think it's also important to underscore when you're talking about Doctors Without Borders, I mean, it was almost exactly a year ago that they were working hand in hand with our military in Africa, taking on the Ebola challenge. They are a valuable international resource, and that's why I do think this requires the absolute top level of scrutiny and independence in the investigation. I'd like to just turn for a moment, again, on your comments regarding the Afghan security forces, which at the end of the day, I really do think is kind of the, you know, the linchpin in terms of a strategy to hand off, you know, power and security in that part of the world. In particular, the ALP, your comment, you made sort of an interesting comment in your testimony about how they were misemployed. And clearly, when we're talking about corruption issues and the need to sort of root out corruption, I mean, they frankly have been a big topic of conversation, again, not with just sort of knee-jerk critics of U.S. Forces over there, but frankly, even people who want to help the mission. Can you talk a little bit about where President Ghani is in terms of the ALP and you know, because again, the criticism is they are kind of gone rogue out there a lot, and there's been complaints within the civilian population about how they operate.
Sure, thanks for the question. We have looked at the ALP or the Afghan police very hard here the last several months. They're authorized about 30,000 in 174 different districts in Afghanistan. And they belong to the Minister of Interior on the police side. What Minister Lumi has done here recently is signed a new directive to go back out to all the provincial police chiefs to make sure that they've done all the right vetting, all the right training, they've got the right leadership in place, and that they don't misuse them. So in some places, ALP have been put out in smaller checkpoints, 5-10 kilometers away from a village. And what they were designed to do is be sort of that village security, that stabilization there. And when they get taken out 5 kilometers, 10 kilometers, without any mutual supporting fires, without other support, reinforcing support, then they become easy targets for the Taliban and other insurgent groups. So not only because of that and the casualties they've taken, not only that, because they do have potentially some issues with leadership taking advantage of that, he has done a holistic scrub of the ALP, and he's continued to try to force the provincial police chiefs to meet all the same standards that we've had in place, and in some places they haven't done that well. So he has re-energized that. We're working hard with him to do that. This past weekend, he had all the provincial police chiefs back into Kabul, and the entire conference was on ALP and how to make sure we don't have some of the issues that you just talked about, sir.
I mean, I think that would send a powerful message that there's real change happening if there's reforms that the government can really talk about.
And sir, as Ms. Davis talked about, one of the things on conditionality, we've really put conditionality on the ALP. So if they don't get through with the reforms, they don't abide by all the vetting procedures, and we don't pay. So that is a condition that we put on them.
Seems like a pretty good leverage. So thank you, General. I yield back.
Mr. Wilson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I'm very grateful to see largely general bipartisan support of your efforts. I've had the great opportunity 12 times over the years of my service in Congress to visit. I've seen a civil society develop. It's just so inspiring to go along streets and see little girls with white scarves going to school, carrying books. It just warms your heart. And then to see little guys with baseball caps, that's not indigenous to Afghanistan. These are people who are truly working to develop a civil society, and I just want to thank you. It's also very personal, my appreciation of your service. My youngest son, Hunter, served as an engineer for a year in Afghanistan. And I just know he was making a difference by helping build that country, rebuild, right, begin from the beginning, so that to protect American families at home, and you have. Additionally, I'm very grateful as a veteran. My unit, the 218th Brigade, served there under General Bob Livingston, our Adjutant General. It was the largest deployment from South Carolina since World War II. 1,600 troops, and they were spread all over the country. And they were helping train forces, and they were so inspired. These are lifelong friends of mine, and they would really let me know what they think. And they think and know that they were working with who they identified as their Afghan brothers. And so this I regret that so much. I can remember the first time I went to Afghanistan with Sheila Jackson Lee. She pointed out that bad news has no feet and, excuse me, what is it? Good news has no feet and bad news has wings. But the good thing is that extraordinary progress has been made. And I agree with the chairman too, that success in Afghanistan is to deny terrorist safe havens, which protects American families. And that we cannot forget, it was September 11, 2001, the attacks on our country that were actually originated, planned, and culminated from caves in Afghanistan. So I'm just very appreciative of your efforts and the largely bipartisan support we have here. With that in mind, that with the special operations reliance of support from conventional forces, if conventional forces are reduced, as has been called for, how can special operations fill in this gap?
Sure, today we continue to tactical level train advise assist with the special operating forces. They continue to build the Afghan capacity and they do a tremendous job. We don't have conventional forces at the Kandak battalion or brigade level. I only have them at the corps level, four of the six corps, and at the ministry level. So we're not really doing that much with the conventional side, but our special operating forces continue to do great work every single day, sir.
Well, with your leadership, I appreciate. Additionally, I'm concerned about the information intelligence sharing between the U.S. and Afghan National Defense and Security Forces as it leads to operations in Afghanistan. Can you speak of what is necessary to improve the coordination cells and advise and assist cells throughout the country?
So we have a dedicated effort, what we call an essential function 7, which is strictly intelligence and how we work with the MOI and MOD to not only share intelligence, but at the same time build their intelligence capability, their enterprise. I think we've made some great strides there. This year they've recently established what they call the Nasrat Center, which is where is basically a national intel fusion cell that brings in intelligence from the MOI, the MOD, the NDS, their intel society, their intel organization, to produce national level targets. They never had that before, and that, the difference that's making is pretty huge. But I think we continue every day to build upon their capacity, and we've seen some great progress in some of the operations based even at the tactical level on the intelligence structure, and not only in the hardware side, but also in the human capital side for intelligence.
Well, and that's so important to prevent collateral damage, which of course is your goal. As I conclude again, I'm just so grateful for your service, for the service of American military personnel. I, having been there, I've seen. My first visit there, the country was totally destroyed. It was the consequence of a 30-year civil war. There was nothing really to see. Except rubble, and then to see the rubble removed, the streets paved for the first time, to see little shops developed, to see opportunity for schools, for bridges to be built, an opportunity, and we sent units to work on agriculture to advance. Thank you very much. I yield my time.
Ms. Tsongas.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, General, for being here today. I appreciate very much your testimony. And like so many, all of us here, I like, and like many Americans, I was so alarmed to learn of the tragedy at the Doctors Without Borders facility in Afghanistan. And I look forward to your investigation and a hopefully very transparent one. But appreciate how serious you are taking this. But I wanted to go to a different place in questioning. As you're wrestling, General, with how best to enable Afghans to secure their country and what kind of support is necessary to aid them in that effort, I'd really like to hear more about what you're doing to ensure that Afghan women, 50% of the country's population, is part of your process. I've been part of a delegation, at least 6 trips over, that focused on one visiting with our women who have so ably served us and for whom we're all so grateful, but also with an emphasis on learning more about the changes that our presence has wrought in the lives of Afghan women. And it's been very promising. Over and over again, you know, we hear the real differences that have taken place. And I remain concerned that whatever our way forward may be, how best we secure those gains, that we don't trade them away in a reconciliation process, that we don't adequately train Afghan national security forces, whether it's the local police, the national police, whatever it may be, because it obviously requires a culture change, and that culture change has begun, but it is very fragile. So I'd like to hear, in your work with the train, advise, and assist with the security forces, how you address the rights of women so that the security forces, who hopefully will remain in place to secure the future life of their country, also are committed to securing the lives of the women who are very much a part of their country.
Ma'am, thank you for the question. Every day, President Ghani, Dr. Abdullah, they speak of this. I think with their leadership and our continued train, advise, and assist, that the future for engaging women in the military, both on the police side and the Army side, continues to improve. And they put more of a spotlight on it, and we continue to assist. And this committee, with some earmarked money, has helped us really emphasize not only infrastructure to house, to take care of women in the military, to protect them, I think has been pretty critical, so we're very thankful of that. I have a women's advisory committee that I co-chair with Ms. Ghani that meets quarterly to talk about different issues. At my level, her level, we meet quarterly, but the committee meets probably weekly. And in fact, Ms. Ghani, over the last month or so, has been meeting weekly to really push some issues on the women's side with both the police and Army, and that's very, very good. As you know, for the police, it's a little bit easier as you recruit women into the police. They go through training. They can serve from where they're at. For the Army, a little bit tougher.
But, General, the question I'm asking really, yes, I think it's very important that the security forces, the local police, whatever, reflect the population. And I appreciate the efforts, especially Congresswoman Davis, in terms of making sure that we at least provide some element of female presence in the Afghan National Security Forces. But the reality is most of those forces are men, and they have a certain cultural, have had a certain historic approach to women. So it's really about how we train the men to protect the rights of women. And I'm curious as to how that piece is moving forward.
Ma'am, they do some of that in their accession training, their officer training, their basic training about rights of not only women but of men. And so I think they're continue to work that. It's about education. It's about training. It's holding people accountable. And I think they continue to get after that. I think as they see more women in positions of increased responsibility, they see more women that are tied in with the special operating forces, which they have women that do that with them to help go on objectives, to search other females. It is actually pretty incredible. And when the other men see this and how that they contribute, I think it does have a change in attitude. But as you know, the Army, the police have only been around for a couple of years. It's going to take time as we move forward. We do put conditions as well on recruiting women, how they do that, and I think they'll continue to improve. But it, you know, as you said, it's going to take time, and it took time for United States Army that's been around for 240 years to get above 15-16% at West Point. So I mean, this is something they're focusing on, and with the leadership of President Ghani, Dr. Abdullah, I see good things forward.
And you've spoken of conditionality, how you use that as leverage to achieve certain goals that there may be some resistance to. Is that a tool in your toolbox as you move forward?
Yes, ma'am, absolutely.
Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you.
Mr. Conway.
Thank you. General, thank you for being here. You mentioned in your opening remarks about your families and the role they've played. You thanked them, and I want to make sure they hear that same kind of thanks and heartfelt admiration for what they've done and how steadfast they are, and allowing you and your team to do what you do. And so thank them very much on our behalf. The recent experience that Khan does with the attack the Taliban did, what can we glean from what the Taliban did, what tactics and procedures, TTPs they use, and then the Afghan response, was it all, or you know, what, you kind of give a grade for that, walk us through that, and what kind of advice and assistance did we provide them in that response, or was it all organic?
Sure, thanks. So thanks for the family piece as well. In Kunduz, quite frankly, the Afghan security forces were surprised. President Ghani has directed a commission to take a look, sort of an after action, to figure out exactly what happened. They're continuing to work that now. But in a nutshell, Kunduz has about 250,000 people in it. Predominantly inside the city is police. Outside the city, there are pockets of the Army. Over the period of Eid, a holiday, many of the senior leadership of the police and some of the Army were not present. The Taliban probably had a lot already inside the town, but right after that time period, they attacked from within the city. The police fought, although they did not take a lot of casualties, and when they didn't see reinforcements from the Army, they kind of melted out. And I don't think the Taliban had any intentions to continue to hold Kunduz, but they got a great IO victory going in there, raising their flag. The difference, though, here, I think, is that the Afghan security forces responded very quickly. They got the right forces up there. They moved a lot of logistical resupplies up there. They changed some leadership out. And once they got right back into the city, the Taliban, for the most part, left. There are, and today, continue to be isolated pockets of resistance and fighting. A very small group inside of an urban area can hold up, you know, battalions worth of people. But they continue to work that very hard. I talked to the Minister of Defense, Stanagzai, this morning, right before I came over here. He was in Kunduz earlier today, and told me that he sees great progress as they move forward. He still said fragile in Kunduz, but he's very confident that all the major areas of Kunduz they own. What did we provide, sir? For the most part, this was Afghan-led. They got themselves back into the city. I had a couple of special operating teams that were south of the city that provided some planning, training advice for the special operating forces. And then I also put an advisory, what we call an expeditionary advisory team, into an airfield south of Kandu so they could provide the Corps level headquarters some planning, logistical planning capability to oversee the Afghans.
Well, thank you. Ghani and Abdullah have been in it for about a year now. What kind of marks would they get for running the trains on time, water, you know, electricity, all the kind of things you'd expect in governmental services? And what does that tell us about the conversation that is out there, that it's a fragile government, that it's likely to not be able to be resilient? Can you talk to us about those two issues?
So I think if you're in Kabul, for the most part, you'd give them probably a C, although with high-profile attacks inside of Kabul, that would be lowered. I think if you're on the outskirts, you're in a faraway province, faraway district, your grade would be much lower because they haven't seen some of the governance they need at that level. But again, they've been the national government on the 29th of September. That was a year. They continue to move forward. It is a very, very tough environment, but they continue to improve. They have made change in almost all the ministers. They've changed out most of the governors. They have some key positions that they have to continue to work on together. On the strategic level policies that Afghanistan is tied into, both Ghani and Abdullah, I think there's no daylight between them. I think the issues they have is when they come to picking people and who's going to be the minister, who's going to be the provincial police chief. But they understand how important that is, and I think they'll continue to do everything they can to make this work. But they do have to engage better with the Afghan people, not only in Kabul, but outside the city, much better.
In the time we've got left, can you give us, from your perspective, the international community's continued financial support? It's going to be key, obviously. It's already been said they can't already afford the forces they've got. Can you talk to us about the expected, or what you see as the international community's heart to stay in the fight?
Sure, thanks. I don't think right now we have donor fatigue. I think that the international community understands how important this is. Next year at the Warsaw Summit, I think July of 2016, they'll look at funding for 2018, 19, and 20, so that'll be critical. I think Afghanistan has to continue to show progress as they move forward, so they keep donor support. But that donor support is absolutely crucial because Afghanistan cannot afford what they have now. They're working it very hard. President Ghani is the right guy to do that with his experience, but the economic environment is going to be very tough.
Thank you, General.
Mr. O'Rourke.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, first, I want to thank you for your service and your leadership, and through you, I want to thank all the men and women who are currently serving in Afghanistan and who have served in the past. I want to ask you a couple of questions about the bombing in Kunduz, or the attack on the hospital in Kunduz. And I recognize that there is an investigation ongoing, but I want to ask you, per your knowledge, why the Afghanistan National Army called that strike at that location.
So again, that's a question that we're asking during the investigation. I wouldn't want to get out in front of the investigation. I need to learn those facts from the investigation. There's a DOD investigation, a NATO investigation, the Afghans do an investigation. We'll be very thorough, very transparent. As soon as I can get those details, I'll make sure the committee has those.
Is there ever a scenario where it is okay to strike a hospital?
Sure, a hospital is a protective facility. We would not target a hospital. So if I can go back maybe to the first part of your question and maybe get at what you're talking about here. When the Afghans call for fire, that's not an automatic response. So every day the Afghans ask me for close air support, and we just don't go fire someplace. That has to go through a rigorous procedure to put aerial fires on the ground, a U.S. process under the U.S. authorities. And so that's what we got to figure out what happened in that case. But I don't want people to think that just because the Afghans call fire that there's automatic fire anywhere they want it. That's not the case.
And my last question on this is, are you aware of press reports within Afghanistan that hospital was treating Taliban and non-Taliban combatants alike, which raised the ire of the Afghan National Forces, who had conducted a raid at that hospital days before or weeks before that strike?
I've seen media reports about Taliban treatment in the hospital, yes, sir, but that's the only thing.
And that would not be a justification for a strike on the hospital?
No.
Okay. Related question, and one that I think you can speak openly about. Can you talk about the terms of our security agreement with Afghanistan and under which conditions we can use lethal force. I understand there are exceptions for counterterrorism activities, there are exceptions for when U.S. forces are under attack, and there are exceptions for urgent situations. Could you characterize our involvement in Kunduz under those exceptions or others that we may not be familiar with?
So again, I'm not going to talk about Kunduz or what happened in Kunduz. And any time we talk about in detail on authorities or rules of engagement, I would not do that in a public hearing. I'll be glad to discuss that with you in a closed hearing, sir.
This might be my last question. How do you balance the need to ensure that we are adequately supporting the Afghan National Army, not abandoning them, and continuing with the train, assist, and advise operations, and not at the same time creating a prolonged moral hazard where they know that U.S. support will be there year in, year out, and they may not make some of the difficult political decisions, investment decisions in their own armed forces and capabilities, decisions with accountability for their leadership that otherwise might be made?
Sure, that's a great question, and I think we work that very hard every single day. We do, they know, and that's why fighting season 15 was completely different. I said up front, you can't compare it with other fighting seasons. The number of forces we had, the level that we had people at, where we do train, advise, and assist made this very different. The ability for us to provide close air support like we have in the past was very different. So there's no doubt in my mind, there's no doubt in the senior military that I deal with on the Afghan side that it is different, and they have to pick up the fight. They have to want this more than we want it. And so I have seen a change in behavior on that. I don't see that as an issue. What I think they're looking at now is how long will our continued support from the international community and the U.S. Be there, and a decision to continue to provide support would make a huge impact in supporting President Ghani, supporting the Afghan people, supporting the Afghan security forces, the impact that would make on the Taliban and the message it sends to them, the message it sends to Pakistan, and the message that it sends to NATO, I think, are pretty huge as well. So decisions here upcoming as we look forward would have an impact on all of those audiences.
Quick question. When will we likely get the results of your investigation of the Kunduz attack?
So I talked yesterday with the investigating officer. He's working that very hard. I should have some preliminary investigation results here in the next yesterday I was asked it, and I said within about 30 days. I don't have an exact date, but as soon as I can get those, I'll make sure we get that.
Thank you. I yield back.
Committee.
Mr. Scott.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman General. Thank you for being here. Just a couple of quick questions, and I want to specifically get to the close air support capabilities. But the Harry Reid has promised earlier this week to uphold the president's veto of the NDAA. The president has not vetoed that legislation yet. But just wondering if you and the other leaders of our military have had the opportunity to speak with the president about the importance of the NDAA since it has passed, and how do you assess the additional risk if that bill is vetoed and the veto is upheld by Senator Harry Reid, as he has promised to do?
Sure, be candid with you. I have not talked to the president on the NDAA, and for the last several weeks, I haven't had time to think about the NDAA. I've been focused on Afghanistan, so I couldn't give you a good answer there.
We ask you to do an awful lot, and on this end of the, with no NDAA, no budget, and certainly you and your men and women are being judged to a standard of perfection, and that's kind of an unfair scenario that I think that we put you in an extremely important mission. I represent Moody Air Force Base, home of the 81st. We are training the Afghan pilots to fly the A-29 light air support aircraft, one of the key aspects of the mission, one of the key capability gaps you said is the close air support. You're expecting these aircraft in theater pretty soon. We originally planned for 40 of them. We're now expected to deliver 20. How many do you expect to see delivered? How many do you need? And could you speak to just that issue generally.
So we're looking forward to getting the A-29 Super Scano. I'll get about six in December timeframe. I'll get more in 16, more in 17. We don't close out the program of record, I think, until mid to late 2018. It'll bring a great capability that the Afghan forces are lacking. I've asked for a holistic study to take a look at the close air support capability of Afghanistan, both in a rotary wing and a fixed wing capability. Until that goes through, sir, I couldn't make a call on numbers. But right now we're looking at 20. But again, I don't get the first five or six till the end of this year, and we'll get them in the fight as soon as we can, and we look forward to that.
And
the Afghans look forward to that, yes, sir.
And you think that they have the ability to, they have enough impact to change the fight?
Sir, if they would have the A-29 this summer, it would have been a game changer in some locations, yes, sir.
Thank you, General, for your service and what you and your men and women do. I yield the remainder of my time.
Mr. Langevin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, I want to thank you for your testimony here today, most especially for your service to our nation, which is invaluable, and I hope you'll pass our appreciation on to the men and women under your command. First of all, General, I'd like to better understand the current situation in Afghanistan, and I hope that today's discussion will continue to not only inform our overall strategy, but will also serve to better protect our men and women in uniform and our coalition partners on the ground. We've seen too many lives lost in this conflict, obviously, and like Master Sergeant Andrew McKenna from Bristol, Rhode Island, who very recently was killed in a terror attack in Kabul. We have to do everything we can in our power to ensure that our policies in Afghanistan maximize our strategic gains while minimizing the tragic loss of lives that we've seen too frequently across the headlines. I make no mistake about it, General, the work that you and the people, men and women in uniform there who are serving in Afghanistan are doing vitally important work, and I know that they are defending us here at home and preventing those who would plot and plan against us from coming here. At the same time, there's still a big frustration on the part of the committee and certainly the part of my constituents that the Afghan forces are not further along in their training and where we need them to be. And I'd like to begin with a New York Times article from yesterday in which a senior Afghan military officer blamed a lack of coordination among Afghan units for recent Taliban advances. This relates to your mention of the need to improved leadership and accountability of ANSAF in your testimony. So I'd like to ask you directly, you know, how do you explain to the committee, how do I explain to my constituents back home as to why after the 14 years of effort and training and presence there and the billions of dollars that we have been spent, the lives been lost, the people that have been injured, why the Afghan forces are not further down the pike in their training, and why are they not where we need them to be? And I'd also like to ask you directly what you'd need with regards to time and resources in order to help build strong leaders ANSAF are missing to sustain themselves beyond our eventual withdrawal.
Sir, thanks for the question. I think very quickly where the Afghan forces, where they plan, where they pre-plan, where they work together, both the cross-pillar organization, the police and the Army, they conduct operations that they work together and pre-plan, they do very, very well. Where they don't, where it's kind of crisis mode, that's where they continue to need help in working that. When they don't work together, you're right, sir, they don't do well. But again, I would say we've been there for 14 years, but this Army continues to be very, very young. We have just started their Air Force the last 3, 4, 5 years. The Army's really only been around for about eight or 9 years. The police, about the same time frame. So it continues to be a work in progress. But I would tell you, they can do a lot of things very well, but the areas that they have issues in are the areas that any Army in a time of war would have problems. So in logistics and sustainment, maintenance, intelligence, close air support, special operating force capability. Those are all very tough pieces for a U.S. Army to do. They've been fighting at the same time. They've been trying to build this Army, And so I see continued progress. I've been there three times, first time in 2002, 2003 timeframe, and where they are today is just light years from where they were then. So I do see progress. Their special operating capability, I mentioned probably last time I was here a story where you took four MI-17s, version 5, flying from Kandahar into Helmand at night, very low visibility, going into a small landing zone, special operators coming off the back, a little iPad device, talking to a Afghan PC-12, giving them full motion video, moving to a high-value target. I told that story and asked people to close their eyes and think about it, open your eyes and think if that was the Rangers, that was the SEALs, that was Delta, that was the Afghan Special Operating Forces. So they have that capability today, and they continue to get better and better. But they do have gaps and seams that we knew they would have that we have to continue to train, advise, and assist on.
Thank you, General. With respect to our drawdown, can you talk about NATO's willingness to step up and add additional resources and forces there to supplement our drawdown?
So from my discussions with the senior members of the partner countries, we have 42 right now with resident support. Most of them, will continue to support, but it's going to take a U.S. decision first before they do that.
Thank you, Jim. Thank you. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Dr. Winstrup.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, thank you for being here today, as always. You know, on September 11, 2001, an attack was launched on America from a place that most Americans never heard of and by a person that most Americans had never heard of. And when I think about the freedom that we enjoy in this country that came flying in our face that day, that it was at risk, I'm reminded of what was etched in a wall of isolation cell that Congressman Sam Johnson spent time in Hanoi Hilton, that said, "Those that have fought and almost died experience the taste of freedom the protected will never know." And I think sometimes your accomplishments and the accomplishments of our military now and throughout history and the freedom that we enjoy are often taken for granted in America. And I think that that needs to be recognized. I think that many in America and some in this room don't fully understand the effort and sacrifice that went behind every one of those ribbons and pins that you wear and so many in our military wear. And I want to thank you for that and all those that serve us in that regard. One of the things that you said today that really stuck out to me, and I think you know why, as a veteran of Iraq, what stood out to me was when you said, "We honor their memory by building a stable Afghanistan." And I think that there's a lot to be said for that. And I think history has shown, and I believe that the greatest chance for peace on this earth comes from a strong U.S. military that can be reactive, can be postured well, and can serve as a deterrent to evildoers. And I think that's really what we're after. I think that's what we want to see happen. And so my question today is, what do you think would be the bare bones level that we can maintain in Afghanistan to prevent a vacuum like we've seen in Iraq? And what level gives you the most comfort or most assurance that that won't happen? And then also, I want to get some of your thoughts on the benefits of the idea that even if we had a stable Afghanistan that was able to stand on its own two feet, would there be benefits to us still being there in a postured position like we do in other parts of the world?
So thanks for the question, and thank you for thanks, sir. I don't want to go into details on numbers and level. Again, I provided options to the senior leadership. I feel comfortable within those options that I've laid it out in terms of risk. Higher is less, less increases at risk in general terms. But I feel comfortable in those options, and I know that senior leadership will continue to look at those and weigh those, and I've provided pros and cons of all that. But it was based on capability as we look forward, so not numbers, but what capabilities needed based on Afghan capability. And then, as you said, I have a U.S. CT mission as well, and we took a hard look and included that in there. I do think on, presence equals influence, and if you have people on the ground, you have influence. And if we're not there to provide influence, somebody else is going to be there. Whether that's Russia, China, Iran, you name it, the U.S. and having people on the ground provides influence.
And long-term benefits from even a stable Afghanistan?
Sure. Afghanistan lives in a neighborhood that doesn't follow the rules. You take a look at the countries that are around it, a very, very tough neighborhood. And again, presence equals influence, building a stable Afghanistan to provide stability in that region, having a partner that wants to partner not only with the U.S. but the other coalition nations is key. We haven't had that the last several years. And I think we have an opportunity today to take advantage of that for a very modest continued investment in both money and personnel.
Thank you very much, General. I yield back.
Ms. Gabbard.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, General Campbell, for being here with us today. You're talking about presence equals influence, and other members have mentioned the instability and the threat of this same brand of Islamic extremism in other countries around the region. Would your recommendation, your strategic recommendation, be to maintain or deploy a U.S. presence and military service members to other countries in the region, such as Libya and Yemen, that are facing similar threats and far greater instability than we're seeing in Afghanistan?
I think Chairman Dempsey, before he left, talked about a regional presence throughout different areas of the world, and I would concur with that.
How long do you suggest that, given the track record for the last 14 years in Afghanistan, that we continue to ask our service members to deploy to Afghanistan on this similar train and equip mission, given the lack of progress that we've seen and given the failures that we've seen in Iraq and in Syria?
Ma'am, I can't talk, Iraq, Syria. I would disagree a little bit on lack of progress. Again, in Afghanistan, I think there's been great progress. I think this fighting season has been very tough, and I'd probably say uneven progress. But there are areas and capabilities that they continue to have issues with that take any army a long time. Building a pilot takes 2 or 3 years. Building a maintainer takes 2 or 3 years. We started that late in Afghanistan. And so that's one area we have to continue to train, advise, and assist on for years to come. They want to take this on, and they have an attitude. They want to do this by themselves. They welcome, I talked about conditionality. And so I think that we have an opportunity here where we have a willing partner, where they want to continue to improve on their own capabilities so they can be a productive country in that part of the region, not only provide for stability and protection for their own homeland and the people there, but also for the region.
So you're seeing an open-ended commitment from the United States military to maintain a presence there?
I think we have to continually assess that, and as we've done over the last several years, we've gone from about 140,000 down to less than 10,000. The amount of money continues to go down, so I think we've been very good in continuing to assess that to bring that commitment down. I said in my opening remarks, this is not without conditions, and it can't be unlimited forever and ever. But I think we have to continue to assess that and make those calls as we go. And I think I've been asked to lay that out for this period in time where the Afghan security forces are, and that's what I've attempted to do.
Given the corruption that we've seen, though, in all levels of the government there in Afghanistan, but including at the lowest levels, and it's been talked about a lot recently, given what happened in Kunduz, with the Taliban's taking over that city for a short period of time, but also people saying that it's likely that that was kind of the first volley, and that one reason that they were able to do so is that the local communities there, and we've seen this in other parts of Afghanistan, because of corruption by the Afghan local police and by local government, people are getting shaken down multiple times and see perhaps the Taliban as the lesser of evils in their daily life and their challenges. What's being done about stemming out and getting rid of this corruption so that the Afghan folks who you've been training can actually do this without us?
Well, thank you for the question. Again, I thank President Ghani, Dr. Abdullah, the MOI, the MOD, the senior leadership I deal with every day tries to get after corruption. They understand that is a huge issue. It's been there for years and years. They're trying to get at it by picking the right leadership, holding them accountable. They're trying to get at it by looking at procurement. They're trying to get at it by providing the right education for their leadership and for the folks that join the Army and the police. I think if you ask most Afghans, they would tell you they don't want the Taliban. The Taliban target, the Taliban kill innocent women and children. The Taliban put suicide vests on little kids and walk them into marketplaces and hold their mother or father hostage, say, "You're going to blow yourself up." I don't believe the Afghan people want that. I know the Afghan people don't want that. They want to secure Afghanistan, and they have that hope because of the Afghan security forces and because of the great work that our men and women have done.
Thank you. Thank you. Just in closing, Mr. Chairman, I think it's deeply concerning to consider the idea that we would ask our service members to go on this nation-building mission across the region, and something that we've got to look at carefully. Thank you.
I appreciate the comments of the gentlelady. I just want to highlight for members that week after next, we're going to spend a week in this committee looking at train and equip around a variety of countries and what's worked and what hadn't. Are there lessons to be learned? Because I agree with the gentlelady, this is a very important issue that we need to dig down deeper on, because there are a number of instances where it has not worked very well, and we need to understand that. So I appreciate the comments. Mr. Nugent?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And first of all, I want to thank General for your leadership to our troops, your service. But as we move forward with the Taliban, what are their abilities to recruit and train? And do we see an uptick in that, or is that stayed level, or has it dropped off?
Sure, you know, I think it at least has stayed stable, or at least has stayed level. Again, they've surged really this fighting season because they know that this is an opportunity for them, because we don't have the coalition out in the numbers we've had. They want to make a statement. They want to remain relevant. They want to show, as potentially it moves to discussion of reconciliation, that they can operate from a position of strength. So they have continued to be able to recruit. When you have somebody there that has no job, no money, no future, and somebody comes and offers you $100, $200 to plant an IED, that's pretty easy to do. So I think what we have to continue to do is show the people of Afghanistan that they have hope and a better future if they continue to support their Afghan security forces and the government. But for the most part, what I see is the Afghan people do not support the Taliban, but there are going to be people that...
So if they don't support the Taliban, where are they recruiting from? Are they recruiting within?
So I think both. They recruit from within Afghanistan, and there's also reports of foreign fighters that come in that assist the Taliban as well.
And how do they train? Do we have a metric on how do they train, or where they train?
So I think there's areas inside Afghanistan that they have potential training areas. There's areas outside of Afghanistan that have sanctuary that provide them the opportunity to train. When they conduct attacks, or it's not something that you would see from a large modern technological force command and control move. And this is counterinsurgency. One or two people put an IED out there. One or two people killing a few people here. A suicide vest going on. So they don't follow the rules. All they have to do is go out there and cause fear in the people, and that's what they want to do. Instill fear to make the government seem as they can't provide the security for the people. So it's going to take everybody in Afghanistan to fight this piece here. But I do not believe the Afghan people support the Taliban for the most part.
And that's good to hear. But, you know, I was there in 2011 and was struck with, as in Iraq and then Afghanistan, actually struck with the security level in Afghanistan versus Iraq in 2011 when we were withdrawing troops. We had more freedom of movement within Afghanistan. We had less restrictions on movement in Afghanistan at that point in time. And now I wonder where we are as compared to 2011. Like I said, when I was in Iraq in 2011, everywhere we went was, you know, fast, quick, you know, with ballistic protection, and was just the opposite in Afghanistan. Has that changed? If I go to Afghanistan today, will I see the same type of movements available to us? I got to visit with the Afghan police training facility.
Sir, quite frankly, where we were in 11 to where we are today in 2015, we don't have that many areas. So most of the areas that you would have to go to, you'd probably travel by helicopter to it, and you'd land in a small location just based on the downsize number of people we have there. So we don't have a lot of folks that end up driving throughout Afghanistan at all, just based on location, based on the density of people that we have there. As far as the Afghans, I think they continue to have, as I said, freedom of movement on Highway 1, which is a ring road throughout Kabul.
In general, one I didn't mean to interrupt, but one last question. In 2007, 2008, my older son was in Afghanistan for 15 months. And he said, Daddy, so, you know, a lot of folks talk about, you know, just long back into the Stone Age. And he said, the problem is they're already in the Stone Age. Has that changed at all?
Sure, absolutely. I mean, I think in especially in the cities, at least, in the outer parts of Afghanistan, you're still going to see people that living in very limited, primitive housing. But inside the city, cell phones, business, internet, you name it, yes, sir, as was mentioned earlier today.
Well, thank you again, General. My time's expired.
Mr. Moulton.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, I want to thank you again for your service and also specifically for your courage, your willingness to come to Washington and say candidly when you disagree with the policy that we're sending your way. So thank you for that. As an Iraq War veteran, it was hard for me to return to Iraq this winter, disheartening to say the least, to see so much of what my colleagues and I had fought for and frankly achieved during the surge gone to waste. And so I'm particularly interested in how you're learning from that experience to make sure we don't repeat the same mistakes in Afghanistan. And one thing that I think stands out in particular to me is that it was not just our rapid withdrawal of troops, but our failure to continue to support and influence the Iraqi government that ultimately led to it falling apart. I mean, in many ways, what happened in Iraq was not just the failure of our train and equip mission as far as the troops go. The Iraqi army just put their weapons down and went home because they had lost faith in a government that had rotted from the inside. And so it was pulling those advisors out of the ministries, out of the prime minister's office. We disdain Maliki, but we forget that he was in power during the surge when we actually had made a lot of progress and had a relatively stable government, but it was because of our influence. So who are you talking with from the Iraq experience to make sure that you don't repeat those same mistakes? And can you give us some examples of things that you're notably doing differently than what we did in Iraq?
So thanks for the question. In Afghanistan, we have a lot of Iraq veterans. Thank you for your service. So all of them, I think, feel as you do there and want to make sure that we don't make, that we learn from our experience. And so as we do different plans, as we've taken a look at the Security Cooperation Office in particular of what would remain in Kabul, how they did that in Iraq versus how they did that in Afghanistan, planners got together with planners that had done that in Iraq. They talked, they worked through that, and we made adjustments based on that kind of discussion. So I feel confident that we've been able to take a look, because as you know, the military does AERs or after action reports on everything we do, and so we have to learn by that, and I think we've done that in that particular case. We've also taken a hard look at how we do set up advisor teams, how we can take expeditionary advising teams as we continue to downsize and provide some level of expertise in particular areas, and I think that's helped us. But I think what you said is key, though. The fundamental difference here for me between Iraq and Afghanistan is that you have a government that is a willing partner here, that wants to continue to have a presence from the international community, that favors that, that wants it, that asks for it, and wants to continue to grow a professional army, a professional police, different than what you saw with Maliki there.
I've heard some reports that that government is suffering from a serious brain drain right now, where a lot of talent is leaving. Are you seeing that, and is it a concern?
Yeah, I mean, it's a concern. The overall refugee piece where young people are leaving Afghanistan is a concern. It's a concern for both President Ghani and Abdullah. They've both spoken about that. But at the same time, I see great potential with the Army, the police, and young men and women that have been trained in the U.S. and the U.K. and Germany, other countries, as they continue to move up and increase responsibility and leadership positions. You know, I see there's some really good talent there. We just got to get them into the right positions.
Now, from the outside, we're seeing cooperation between President Ghani and Abdullah Abdullah. Are they actually sharing power, or is that an area of concern as well?
I mean, the national government is hard, and I think they have to continue every single day to work at it. The president is the president. There's no doubt, I think, in his mind or Dr. Abdullah's mind who the president is. But I think, again, on policy matters, they continue to work very close on that. There's no daylight between them on there. They work together in the National Security Councils. They work together in the cabinet meetings. But they know there's no other choice here as they move forward.
General, one last question following on Mr. Scott's question earlier. Both the chairman and the Secretary of Defense have testified before this committee that using OCO funds to fund the base budget of the Department of Defense is not a satisfactory way to ensure our national security. Do you agree with that position?
So what I agree is I've been very fortunate to have the resources and that I need. I've had the right people trained and equipped, and that is because they've done it by OCO. But as I think everybody's mentioned, it is very hard for any of the services to continue to plan when you go year by year.
I think it's just important for you to understand that, you know, that is the rationale the president has given for voting against the NDAA. It's the rationale that myself and others who have taken that tough vote have used as well. We hope that we can change that situation by forcing the issue. It's in no way a reflection of our lack of confidence in you and the troops on the front lines. Thank you.
Ms. Walorski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And General, I again want to thank you for being here. And I so much to my colleagues' comments here, I so much appreciate your candor. It's really a it's just a fresh moment to have a bottom line general come in and basically say, you know, here's what I think to the president. And I guess, you know, a couple of comments that I have is that I think, and I appreciate the gentleman's questions and opinion, but I happen to have the opposite opinion. I think that we're talking about symptoms in here, and I think that we need to remind the American people that over the last few years, certainly in my short tenure in Congress, there really has been a vacuum of foreign policy, and there's been a lot of reactionary things happening. There hasn't been a whole lot of support that I've seen from this administration, and I think that when you have a president that stands up and is willing to volley back and forth politically the entire defense budget, which absolutely has everything to do with the allocation of the good people you get, the money to support them, I think it's very, very dangerous, and I think the American people understand that. And I do appreciate so much your not being able to talk to us specifically about the troop drawdowns. The things I've seen in the media have been anywhere from 1,000 to 5,000 to 8,000. And I guess I really appreciate your comment where presence equals influence. I just want to make sure that we're talking about, for the record, when there is less presence, there's less influence, there's greater risk. And that counts across the board. So that would count with counterterrorism, train, advise, assist, force protection, and missions. Is that not correct? Isn't that what presence equals influence means? The less presence, the greater the risk.
Yeah, I wouldn't argue with that statement, ma'am.
And then my other question, General, nobody's really talked about, but I'm concerned because, and some of my other colleagues talked about policy, that you're just implementing the policy that we're sending. Well, again, I think it's not we are sending policy. There's an administration sending policy that many times can't be understood, has created a vacuum for the enemy, and the American people certainly don't understand, as the losses in Iraq, as the presence of Russia right now in Syria. And I think certainly with the Iranian proposal that was signed, do you detect currently, are you concerned about increased Iranian presence and what that means as you share a border now that we're venturing in by an administration's desire to sign this agreement with Iran?
Ma'am, I won't go into policy, but I would tell you that, and I talked in the SASC as well about Iranian influence on the Taliban and providing Taliban a support to fight ISIL as they saw it. So President Ghani, security forces are concerned and the impact that would have from Iran on its western flank. If I could add, though, on not really policy, but as I've gone forward and asked for flexibility for 2015, the administration gave me that flexibility. As I asked for enablers, a bridging strategy, and authorities, I was able to get that as well. So again, I'm very comfortable as I provide options to my senior leadership that they put due diligence and scrutiny on that, and that's what I would expect. I think that's what the American people expect.
Sure. And then to the just a further question on Iran and the forces that you're suggesting, does that take into account a new level of activity with Tehran and Kabul?
Maybe not specifically, ma'am, as we looked at that. Again, we've seen reports of that. I've talked to that with the Minister of Defense and the impact that would have in Herat specifically on the West. We do have an Italian contingent led by the Italians out in TAC West that gets some of those reports, but I don't think we looked at that specifically as we looked at the capabilities that are required.
Sure, and so I guess my final question is, so as we launch into uncharted waters with this agreement with Iran, and should you see the need for things going awry for additional training, help, forces, money, people, personnel, should anything happen on that border, do you feel like you have the flexibility with this administration to go back again and tell the administration, also the American people, hey, something's wrong here, we need help?
And whether it's on the west, the north, the south, or the east, you know, my job is to provide the best military advice. And if I see issues that I have concerns on force protection or the train advise and assist, I would absolutely raise that to my leadership.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And General Campbell, thank you for your service to the nation. I think Americans are getting tired of being bogged down in Afghanistan. We've been there for 13, 14 years, and it seems that there's no end in sight. It seems like we are doomed to always maintain a troop presence there. And I don't think that that's something that that is good for our country. For us to be nation building forever in Afghanistan. That's exactly what the future holds for us. There is no point in our plans or in the plans of those who want to build the nation of Afghanistan. There is no stopping point. Because whenever you do stop, there's going to be some adjustments that have to be made. So why not make the adjustment now? Why not draw down our troops? If the Russians or the Chinese want to come in and be players over there, good for them. I would think that they would not want to embroil themselves over there. They would probably want to see the locals work everything out. What do you say to that?
So I would say that we have continued to redeploy and draw down our forces. We have continued to, we had 300 or 400 different outposts when I was there in 2010, 2011. We're down to less than 20 today. Yeah. So we have continued to draw down both our forces, and I think we've drawn it down responsibly. So I'm thankful that we've had the ability to do that. So I think as we look forward, what we're trying to do is make sure that we continue to provide the Afghan support where they need it, and so we can do that reasonably and responsibly as we continue to draw down. But in the areas that are very tough for them, in the close air support and other areas, having a stable government, having a stable Afghanistan is not only good for Afghanistan, it's not only good for the region, but it's also good for the United States.
I understand that, but it just seems like stability is not there, and there'll be no stability in the short term or in the foreseeable future. There won't be any stability with the U.S. presence there, with our 10,000 troops. Do you believe that we should just maintain that force level for the foreseeable future, or should we think about drawing down even further?
Sure. As I said earlier, I've provided options to the senior leadership that weighs up pros and cons of different force levels based on different risk, and I said up front, I don't believe that it should be unconditional, and that it shouldn't be forever and ever, and we have to continue to work through that. You know, if you look at Korea, if you look at Germany, and the amount of forces that we continue to have those countries 70 years later, would Korea or Germany be as stable as they are today?
Well, that's exactly what the American people are looking forward to with Afghanistan, is a multi-decade presence over there. And if we do maintain ourselves as targets over there, as long as we're supporting the Afghan government, a corrupt government, which does not have the full allegiance of the people, which that is highly factionalized over there, if we maintain our presence over there and being a target for those who just simply want to drive us out, then we're just stuck. And I don't believe that's a good thing for America.
I'm not sure the question, but I don't think they're trying to drive us out. The government wants us there.
Well, I think we're getting sick and tired of being sick and tired of the same thing happening over and over again in Afghanistan, and I think it's time for us to look at closing up shop. And with that, I will yield back.
Ms. Stefanik.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, General Campbell, for your testimony today, for your service, and for your family's support over your decades of service to our nation. Earlier this year, I had the opportunity to participate in a delegation visit to Afghanistan with Mr. Wilson, Mr. Moulton, and Mr. Ashford, my colleagues on this committee. And in addition to meeting with our troops deployed, we also visited with President Ghani. And one of the issues that President Ghani raised was the threat of Daesh within Afghanistan. And in your written testimony today, you state, quote, Daesh has grown much faster than we anticipated, and its continued development in Afghanistan presents a legitimate threat to the entire region. In the last year, we have observed the movement's increased recruiting efforts and growing operational capacity. I wanted to see if you could elaborate on specifically what you're seeing on the ground in terms of that increased recruitment efforts, their operational capacity, and their presence in the 34 provinces in Afghanistan.
Well, thank you, ma'am. I'm sorry I wasn't there when you came through. In fact, I was back here, I think, testifying, and thank you for taking the visit. Daesh, or ISIL-KP, continues to be a concern of President Ghani, Dr. Abdullah, the security forces. Pakistan has issues with Daesh as well. I've talked to General Hill about that. I think if you talk to President Ghani about it in terms of recruiting, what he would have told you is Al-Qaeda was Windows 1.0, Daesh is Windows 7.0, and their ability to use social media to get out and recruit. Having said that, Daesh and Taliban ideology, they're different, and so they continue to fight each other, specifically in the province of Nangarhar in the east, and that's where we've seen the biggest presence of Daesh. There are reports throughout the different provinces, upward of probably 25 plus provinces, we've had reports of Daesh, but the significant presence is really in the east and in Nangarhar. It's down in northern Helmand a little bit, and probably in Saripol and Herat and Gore in the west, but predominantly in Nangarhar. I don't believe today, you know, when I was here in February, March, I would have said it was nascent. Today, I'd say it's operationally emergent. So we have to continue to watch. We have to continue to make sure that the Afghans apply pressure on ISIS or Daesh to make sure that doesn't continue to grow. As you know, they are very barbaric, brutal, and they've shown instances of that in Afghanistan as well by cutting off heads of captives, by kidnapping, by taking men and women, throwing them on a pile of IEDs and blowing that up. So again, the Afghan people have no time for Daesh there, and the Afghan security forces want to continue to go after that.
What is your assessment of Afghanistan's approach to countering recruitment efforts? You talked about Daesh's successful social media, which we're seeing throughout the Middle East today, and frankly, globally. What is your assessment of what President Ghani and his administration are doing in countering that?
I think a lot of it is the educational piece. They're trying to work that in the universities. They're trying to work that through radio, TV, campaign ads, and showing the benefits of having a unit of government supporting the Afghan security forces. You know, I don't think, for the most part, they have to. Well, they show video of how brutal Daesh is. You know, that really just turns the people away. So they have to continue to work that very hard. I think they've done a good job at that, and they'll continue to try to work together both with the Resolute Support Forces on the ground and the neighbors in the region. President Ghani's approaching this really from a regional standpoint and has said, you know, we're fighting Daesh, we're fighting this for the entire region, we got to continue to reach out. And they'll hold a conference here, I think the end of October timeframe, where they bring in all the operational and the intelligence arms of all the surrounding countries to talk specifically about Daesh and how they can combat that together.
Thank you very much. I yield back.
Mr. Aguilar.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it.
General, appreciate you being here. Can you give us a size, just as a follow-up to the last question, can you give us a sense of the size of Daesh and ISIS and their presence in the region?
You talking about just a number, sir?
Yes, sir.
This would be, this would be a guess, but open source reporting would be anywhere between 1,000 and 3,000.
And your best guess on what that will look like in the next few years, if not managed or contained?
Well, sir, they have their stated goal is to build a Khorasan province that includes Afghanistan, parts of Pakistan. They want Jalalabad out in the east to be the capital of the Khorasan province, so they're going to continue to fight hard in Nangarhar. They want to spread that north up into Kunar and Nuristan. And unchecked, they'll continue to grow a base. But I do believe the Afghan security forces understand this. There's operations ongoing today that are going after Daesh in Nangarhar by both the Army and the police in the 201st Corps, which is based in Nangarhar.
We've understand and we've read that some members of the Taliban have gone over toward these networks. Can you give us a sense, because of the change in leadership, can you give us any other discussion or comments about other reasons why they have made that transition?
Yeah, I think a lot of it, there's been a lot of TTP, Pakistan Taliban, that has switched over. There's been regular Taliban that have switched over, or have at least publicly expressed allegiance to ISIL, Daesh. I think some of it is they think they're going to get more resources. They look at it as maybe more media attention. And so I think for a lot of these reasons, you have some folks that don't want to come back into the government, that don't want to reconcile, that want to continue to fight, and they'll join something new like Daesh that's coming up there. And they see what's happening in Iraq and Syria. And for whatever reason, why somebody would want to do that, I couldn't tell you. But they see that as something they want to do, and they continue to join that. But again, I think from a regional standpoint, President Ghani, Dr. Abdullah, General Raheel, they want to fight this. They want to continue to get it now before it grows out of control, as you talked about.
Thank you, General. Appreciate it, Mr. Chairman. I'll yield back.
Thank you. Mr. Knight.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, General, for your service. I just had a couple quick questions. Can you give me an idea of the definition of train and assist? When we went, I went over to Poland and some other countries with the chair and other members, and I was thoroughly impressed with the Polish soldiers and the interaction that we had with U.S. forces. So can you give me an idea of what train and assist means for the Afghans? What's going to happen when they're done, when they're through with their training? What can we expect from them? How they're going to interact? Those types of things.
Sure, thanks for the question. Again, the numbers that we have right now, as the chairman asked me early on, we're really working on the ministerial level, and at the ministerial level, we're focusing on what we call 8 essential functions. So in the intelligence realm, in the planning, programming, budgeting, execution realm, transparency and accountability, sustainability, intelligence, strategic communications. What we do at that area is our trainers are now really our new weapon systems, and we have much more senior folks, so where this war would have been about privates and captains and sergeants, lieutenants, our advisors are more senior, generals and lieutenant colonels and colonels and great senior civilians, and they're trying to bring this technical expertise to build the capacity of the Afghan ministry, so in the interior and the defense. We don't have people at their basic training. We don't have people providing them, marksmanship training. They do all that themselves. So the Afghans, for the most part, do all their own training, EOD training, all of that. The technical areas that they don't have the expertise, in the maintenance areas, in pilots and growing their Air Force, that's where we continue to have to do the train, advise, and assist.
Okay, very good. And, with the recent issues with Russia, and their strikes in Syria, can you give me an idea of the level of maybe the weekly or monthly interaction that you get with, and I'll use different terms than I'm sure are used now, but maybe between USAR commanders and people of that level, that the four stars are going to get together and talk about what's happening in the region. I know that this region is quite a bit to the west of you, but
it is going to affect maybe what happens in Afghanistan, maybe what happens in now that we're getting strikes from the Caspian Sea. I would expect that there are kind of connective interactions between the commanders, between what's happening now.
So I talked to General Austin, who's the CENTCOM commander, several times a week. I do have email and video teleconference and telephone conversations with General Breedlove, who's SECUR. I've talked to General Rodriguez, the AFRICOM commander. I know that AFRICOM, UCOM, and CENTCOM talk quite frequently to understand because, as I said up front, terrorism has no boundaries.
Correct.
So very good relationship between the combatant commanders there. But I mostly talk to General Austin through CENTCOM based on the region I'm there. I did have the opportunity a couple weeks ago to go to India to talk to some of the senior leadership in India to talk about Afghanistan, how that plays, how they're tied in with Afghanistan, what that means to China and Pakistan. Really quite helpful for me, and also to explain how Afghanistan is tied into that. President Ghani, again, is reaching out to the entire region. I think is quite helpful. Last Monday, I was in Germany for a day with General Austin. We brought the chiefs of defense from five of the countries surrounding Afghanistan to bring them together to talk. Pakistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Kyrgyzstan all came together to talk about regional issues, border issues, drug smuggling, what they can do to enable each other to fight this common enemy. So that was quite good.
Very good. Thank you, General.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Ms. Duckworth.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General, thank you for being here. I want to talk a little bit about the capacity of the Afghan troops that we are training. From your testimony, you characterize the security forces' performance of the Afghan National Defense Security Forces as uneven, inconsistent, still require broad support. You talk about the fact that without key enablers and competent operational level leaders, they can't handle the fight alone. In contrast, you talk about the ASSF and how they are actually able to mount operations and seem to be much more successful. What I'm concerned is that we seem to be talking a lot in our metrics about our training of security forces in terms of numbers. How many do we think they need to accomplish the mission, as opposed to the capacity or the quality of the forces? I just think that we're a little over-focused on building up troop levels in terms of quantity. You laid out a few significant threats that we face in Afghanistan and in the region. So as the president evaluates what right troop and advisor levels are, could you explain what the primary issues and variables are that continue to plague the security forces' ability to carry out its mission independently, and compare that to the ASSF, who seem to be able to have the capacity to do this on their own?
Thank you, ma'am, for the question. I was very tough on the Afghan security forces in my written comments there, and I've talked to the Afghan partners about all of those. And again, you have to have that type of relationship to be able to continue to improve, and I value that with both the MOD and the MOI. And again, we're not at the levels of the Kandak Battalion Brigade. We're on four of the six corps, and we're at the ministry level. So some of those comments really focus at the senior leadership. And what I've told President Ghani is that if you pick the right leaders, you put the right leadership in place, and you hold them accountable, that's going to take care of about 70% of the issues that we see day to day out there. One of the reasons that the Afghan Special Forces, the ASSF, are where they're at is because we continue to provide train, advise, and assist at the tactical level with them today. And we don't do that with all the conventional forces. They also have the ability, based on their size, much smaller, and the training that they go through, that they have a very good force generation cycle. So they're able to go training, they're able to take some leave, and then they know they're going to go into the fight. For the most part, in the rest of the police and the rest of the operational force, they don't have that. So if you're down in Helmand and you've been there for 3 years, you've probably been in a consistent fight for 3 years. And you've had very little opportunity to train. You've had very little opportunity to take leave. And they're really working hard at trying to figure out how they can work this force generation cycle into the conventional side. And they really want to get after that as one of their priorities if they have sort of a winter lull after this fighting season. I think if they can get there, their performance would continue to improve. They have some very good young leadership at the captain, the lieutenant colonel level. They got to continue to progress. They need more experience. So although I was very, very tough in some of the words there, I do believe that they continue to improve and that they're very resilient. And with continued time, they'll get much, much better.
So would one of the key contributing factors to their high AWOL rates and this lack of sufficient force generation level, and then I'll just ask my second question. You can take the rest of the time to answer. Since it is Throwback Thursday, I'm going to use an old-fashioned term. I do feel like that there's a real lacking in the Green Tab leadership training that's going on here, that those frontline leaders, because in your testimony, you talk about the fact that when they do execute deliberate cross-pillar operations that are planned and resourced, they're actually successful. So what is going on there? We have the high AWOL levels at that Green Tab leadership, the young, even more junior than your lieutenant colonels, but even younger than that. Is that what's going on, the company grade folks?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. The attrition level, or a lot of the reason because of the attrition in the AWOL, is because of poor leadership. They don't have sergeants, they don't have company commanders, platoon leaders that know everything about them and take their welfare into consideration like we do back in all of our services here. They don't have that non-commissioned officer corps. We're trying to build that. That's the backbone of all our services that would look after those type of things. So they're working on that. And then, as you said, the force generation cycle, if they got that better, that would reduce the level of attrition as well. What we are trying to do on the leadership piece is, and I know you'd be familiar with this, on pre-command course. So we've initiated a pre-command course for their lieutenant colonels. Before you're a battalion commander, you have to go through a leadership pre-command course. Before you're brigade commander, you have to go through the same thing. We've started, have not run yet, a capstone type course for their general officers, and that'll get initiated. So their human capital and leadership piece, we have to continue to work.
It's year 14, though. We have, I don't know how many more years we can keep doing this, but thank you for your testimony. I yield back.
Mr. Russell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I guess as I look at these colors on the wall behind us, on them is our 11 streamers from the Philippine campaign. And from 1899 to in the mid 1913 to 15 period is when those 11 streamers were earned. And we debated these same things in this Congress about the worthiness of, can we train the Philippine Constabulary? Can we track down Emilio Aguinaldo and bring him to justice? Can we deal with the insurgents and the moral warriors? Can we? And yet, we did. We transitioned the government successfully. We did capture Emilio Aguinaldo and execute him and bring him to justice. We saw our warriors achieve all of that, despite what we here in the halls of Congress often question. I look back on 9/11. At that time, two-thirds of the country was under the control of the Taliban. Very little of it was under the hands of anyone that had freedom. Girls weren't allowed to go to school, couldn't fly a kite. It was haram to play a radio or to play chess in Kabul. I remember it. We've seen successful elections in the transition of government successfully. I remember working with the British 2nd Parachute Regiment and 3rd Special Forces when the Afghan National Army was nothing but 600 people that showed up. And now we see 150,000. And Mr. Chairman, what strikes me is that isn't it wonderful that we're debating 150,000 troops in the field and their capacity for intelligence and command and control and complex operations in an urban and rural environment? Thank God we've reached that point to get to that point and that we're having the debate and this discussions, and it's due to warriors like this that are sitting before us that makes that possible. General Campbell, thank you for your perseverance and patience in enduring our questions. The Status of Forces Agreement, often we saw that was problems with the Iraq experience. And I know we're much further along with President Ghani, and I know from having worked personally with Dr. Abdullah at an Afghan National Security Conference in Geneva, Switzerland in 2002, that we do have some capability there in Kabul with the leadership. Are there any limitations on the Status of Forces that you can see moving forward? as we morph the troops, their based embassy, not strike force, not training assist, any shortcomings that we can assist you with on the status of forces agreement?
Sure, I've seen none, and if we've had issues, I've gone to President Ghani and we've worked through those, but absolutely none right now.
And that's very encouraging. And you also made note that the strength of the ANA was that it was not fractured. I think that's an important point. They haven't broken. They've retaken ground. They've regrouped. They are determined to fight. They don't drop their weapons and run. Could you speak to that a little bit?
Sir, absolutely. And, you know, people try to compare Iraq and Afghanistan. I tell them it's absolutely different. In Helmand, in July timeframe, Taliban took over a district center called Musakala. It took the Afghans a little bit of time to reorganize. They changed out some leadership. They put a battalion commander in jail because he ran. So they did make the right corrections. They resupplied. They got back into Musakala, took over the district center. But it took them a couple of weeks to do that. They were very methodical as they went about that, but they eventually got that done. In Kunduz, they did that much quicker, and within a couple of days they were back inside of the city, and they've taken a hard look, just like all of our services will, to figure out why that happened, to make sure it doesn't happen someplace else. And that's a sign of a professional army, a professional police, and a sign of a government that wants and cares for their security forces. Quite frankly, you know, President Ghani is a commander-in-chief, and that's different than what we've had there before.
Well, and I appreciate that. In fact, I think about our own history in the United States Army. 40 years after our formation, we broke and ran and left this capital exposed in 1812, and it was set on fire. I'm glad that our nation didn't give up on us at that time. The authority to strike Daesh, are you allowed any independent, or are there any prohibitions on your command level to strike Daesh independently, or does it have to go through the Afghan structure?
So I can strike insurgents if they're a force protection issue to our forces.
Thank you, and thank you, sir, for your dedicated service to our nation. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you. Ms. McSally.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Campbell, good to see you again. Thanks for your continued service to our country and everything you're doing in Afghanistan. It was great to see you in May when we were over there on the congressional delegation. I know the current situation with the hospital is under investigation, but I wanted to just ask about the targeting process in general. Since the last time I was over there in uniform with my A-10s, we were, and when my time in the Air Operations Center, we would usually strike under two different circumstances, either counterterrorism, dynamic targeting, in which case decisions and positive identification and collateral damage, all that stuff was done back at the headquarters with approval to then strike, or we were under a Joint Terminal Attack Controller's control, a JTAC, in close air support. And obviously we had U.S. troops very much deployed all over the nation in that time. But even sometimes the JTAC was back at headquarters and not, you know, in the fight that we were hitting. But they were still the ones that were, you know, calling the shots and making sure we had the PID and the collateral damage assessment. Can you just walk me through what the, and maybe you can, maybe this is not in the setting, maybe a classified answer, what the targeting process is right now, both if it's just on the U.S. side, but also if, you know, the Afghans are asking for support. How do we go through that and make sure we have PID and CDE? And do you see any, I can imagine you see challenges as we have less forward presence and being able to get that PID and CDE done correctly. So if you could just share that. And again, if you need to talk classified, we can do that afterwards.
Ma'am, I'd rather go to a classified session and give you that. I would say that though we continue to ensure that we have PID. We're very, very precise. And, you know, it's very rigorous. And so I can cover all those in a class.
Great. I mean, but is it safe to say that with the troops being pulled back more to centralized locations and less numbers, that it's just more challenging for us to get that good intel in order to reach PID?
It may be more challenging, but, you know, that means I would not,
absolutely,
would not drop.
Absolutely. Right? I totally agree with that. Great. So it just becomes more of a challenging situation. And what about if the Afghans ask for support? Again, we can just want to talk about that in classified setting.
As I said up front, if the Afghans ask for support like they do almost every day, then it still has to go through
our process.
Our process. Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
Great. Thank you. When we talked to you in May, there was some setbacks, I would say, or delays in moving some of the things forward that we were trying to do with the ANSF because of the fragility of the unity government being formed and some delays, and obviously sitting a defense minister, and a lot of that seemed to have brought some things to a standstill. Similarly, the uncertainty as to whether we were going to be there and how long we were going to be there and at what time we were pulling out was creating, when we talked to individuals in the Afghan security forces and parliament and others, that uncertainty was creating a lot of angst and just delaying a lot of things that we were trying to move forward. Has anything changed since we talked in May, and have things gotten better?
I think in some areas better, some they're about the same. I think on the Ministry of Defense, although Minister Stanigzai is an acting minister, he has really taken charge. I got great trust and confidence in him. He's got a great vision for the future of the Ministry of Defense. We all thought that he would be the minister, and on July 4th, he didn't get through the parliament, but he has been in an acting capacity. He's doing quite well, and I think it would do good for the parliament there to ensure that Minister Stanigzai continues to serve in that position. In other areas, there have been some holdbacks waiting for, I mean, there's going to be people that are waiting to find out where the U.S. is going to go post-2016. I think they're pretty comfortable for 2015 okay. into 16, but after that, we do get a lot of questions on that.
Great, thanks. What else can we do to help build the Afghan National Air Force and the closer support capability that they need? Is there something else you need from us, whether it's authorities, resources, platforms? I know you've touched on it in your testimony, but can you just share what else we need to do to be able to? Because if they don't have CAS, then obviously that's a significant shortfall for them.
Right. I think everybody back here, OSD, everybody's working very hard to get after that. So part of it is going to take time. It takes 2 to 3 years to get a pilot through.
Right.
Afghanistan understands they have to make some tough decisions, you know, kind of left of the boom. So 2 or 3 years out, they got to put the right number of people in with the right training to get through pilot training. And if they don't make those decisions now, you know, it's going to take longer and longer. So we work with them very hard on that. But I think everybody's working hard to get there. There are some restrictions that inhibit or have inhibited in the long haul on their Mi-35s and Mi-17s we're all working through. Quite frankly, when they started the fighting season, they had 5 Mi-35s, today they have 2. Mm. And at the end of this fighting season, just based on structural integrity of the aircraft, they won't be able to fly, and they'll be down to Mi-17s, which are not designed to be a close air support platform. We do have MD-530 Little Bird helicopters coming in, and as soon as we get the fixed wing aircraft that we talked about earlier, the A-29, that will help. But we're taking a holistic look at what they really need based on the continued fight, wear and tear, the attrition level of the aircraft, that kind of thing.
Great, thanks. And again, thanks to you and your family for your continued faithful service to the country. I yield back.
Thank you. General, appreciate you patiently answering all of our questions. More importantly, I very much appreciate you and those who serve with you for what you do every day to protect the security of our nation by working with the Afghans and in other ways. It's challenging circumstances. Part of those challenges are external environment. Part of them are placed upon you by the chain of command. But I think it's clear to all of us that you are making the most of the situation for the country's security, and we're very grateful for your service. With that, the hearing stands adjourned.
Thank you, Chairman.
but yet it has consequences. Yeah, well, it's interesting.
Well, and I wanted to ask you about that. You made those open comments, but you've heard quite a bit of frustration from a lot of lawmakers about, you know, the length in this. I mean, is that a matter of expressing that sentiment better? Is that, I mean, how do you counter those feelings of, you know, we need to get out, we need to end this?
Well, there are legitimate frustrations. I mean, I was surprised when General Campbell said, although I've heard him say something like this before, you know, we've really been training the Army for 8 to 9 years, Air Force for about the last 3. Why did we wait so long? Maybe we were so absorbed in defeating Al-Qaeda, et cetera, that it has taken that long, you know. So I don't think it was, you know, malfeasance, but there are legitimate frustrations. Mm-hmm. The rest of the story is this takes a long time. How long have we been in Colombia, for example? But look at where they are now versus where they have been. So that's the reason that we're going to spend a whole week on this subject week after next. Train and equip, not just Iraq, Syria, and Afghanistan, but historically in a broader context. What are the lessons? Is it always hard? Are there particular circumstances in every country beyond our control? Or are there lessons that we can apply more broadly to different countries and our efforts to improve their security forces? We can't do everything ourselves. Mm-hmm. So somebody's got to be out there helping us do it. We're trying to work with others. You just heard somebody today mention Poland. We have allies of different capabilities. How well are we organized, equipped, prepared to work with those different capabilities? I think this is a big, very important question.
So are those hearings going to be oversight or are they going to be education? Is it going to be just
both? So we're going to have a closed roundtable. We're going to have outside experts. We're going to have administration witnesses at different events. So it's try to understand, but it's also hone in on what we're doing now and is it working or not, or are there things to do differently.
And that's all going to be the week that you come back?
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
So do you think we're going to have an answer from Obama on the troop level?
I don't know. He said he's given him the recommendations but he also said, if you heard it, that it's really important that we provide some reassurance and stability to this fragile unity government so they know we're not bailing on them at the end of the year.
NATO said today that they're willing to put more troops there or keep more troops there.
But they're going to follow us. You know, U.S. leadership is what matters. So I don't think NATO's going to be there if we're not there. But if we're there, then I do think these other countries will contribute, absolutely.
8 or 9 years is kind of a long time, though. Why do you think the U.S. effort at training and equip hasn't worked up to this point in Afghanistan?
Well, that's what we want to explore, not only with Afghanistan, but other countries as well. You know, I do think we shouldn't be too cavalier at how hard this is. Who was it? Somebody today said when they were there in 2002, 2003, there were like 600 folks in the Afghan army basically guarding the presidential palace. So, you know, and meanwhile, they've been under constant war during this time. So I don't want us to kind of have this arrogant attitude, you know, why aren't y'all like us in a year or two? But on the other hand, there are a lot of frustrations, not just Iraq, I mean, Afghanistan, but Iraq and obviously Syria here recently. So, it's our job to understand why things have not gone as well as we wanted and to see what we might have done differently or what we might do differently in the future. Not just the way we train people, but maybe we're not organized right. Maybe we don't have the right authorities, which is Congress's bailiwick, on train and equip issues. Maybe we make it too cumbersome. I'm not presupposing all the answers. I'm just saying I think this is a big question that applies in lots of regions of the world, and we've got to do better because we can't go fix everything ourselves. And yet the security situation in these faraway countries affects us.
So. On the House leadership race, are you concerned that Freedom Caucus members are going to ask a potential speaker to agree to things?
Oh, I'd be concerned if any group tried to put conditions on anybody running for leadership. I don't think that's a good idea. So anyway, speaking of which, I'm headed there. Great. I'm sorry that y'all can't join in the fun and excitement.
Wish we could.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Political endorsement? Occasionally. All right, man, have fun.